it right there because I'm super excited to introduce today's guest on the Circle of Knowledge podcast. Once again, this is your host, John Kovach Jr., founder and creator of Champion Circle Networking Association, and so much more, but I can't wait. We were just in the green room backstage before coming onto the show, and I just had that like butterfly moment because I really got to meet for the first time today a hero of mine in the sport of track and field, somebody that I just value, I appreciate. They're entertaining as heck, and I can't wait to interview this individual and to express just so much appreciation, but also highlight them in a way that the world gets to see what's behind the scenes of the athletic life and career. For those of you who know, my background is in athletics, as I was training for the Olympics in 2012, but pivoted my career to entrepreneurship. And yet when I still live vicariously through my heroes on social media and on the world stages, I get a sense of pride and just fulfillment watching these individuals represent what the sport is all about. And I've been able to dig in deep and meet several Olympic athletes who have been there, done that, and done some amazing things. This is one of the few athletes that I'm so excited to highlight on our show. With everything being said, and before I bring this individual on, again, welcome back to the Circle of Knowledge podcast. And we're so excited that you're here. And thank you for making this possible. If you're listening to this or if you're watching the live show, I just want to say congratulations. Thank you. And thank you for your support. All of the five-star recommendations and the beautiful questions and comments you guys leave. Also, the funding that goes into sponsoring and supporting our show to make this possible. I really appreciate it. And so does the team. And we have a lot of fun. As you could tell, we could splurge a little bit of time and resources and pick some things off the internet to show you some cool clips of the amazing human being I'm about to interview. Well, without any further ado, I want to read her bio because Alysha Newman is one of my athletic heroes. Alysha Newman is a two-time Olympian, model and influencer, one of the top women's pole vaulters of all time. Alysha is the reigning Commonwealth Games champion and Canadian record holder. She was born and raised in London, Ontario. The gymnast turned pole vaulter became the first female high schooler to clear 4 meters, earning herself a scholarship to the University of Miami. Where she went on to become a 6-time All-American, school record holder, and the ACC champion. Newman graduated with a bachelor's degree in kinesiology and sports medicine before starting her professional track and field career, signing with Nike in 2018. There's more, guys. I got to do her total justice, so I'm her ultimate hype man. While she calls the Toronto area home, Alysha spends more than half of the year traveling to competitions, training camps, and all the things that go involved with being a worldwide competitor. This dynamic lifestyle, along with her passion for music, fashion, and food, have contributed to Alysha's rapidly growing social media profile. She uses this platform to inspire and empower others to live their best lives by sharing the importance of nutrition, rest, and general wellness practices. Whenever she gets the opportunity, Alysha loves to engage with young women, encouraging them to live well-balanced lifestyles and to learn through failure and adversity. Without any further ado, help me bring to the stage the amazing Alysha Newman. I wanted to start the
slow
clap.
Oh, boom. My gosh. I was like, woo! I was like, hey, I'm in here. You got me all hyped. My heart rate just went up. I got to check my heart rate right now.
Woo. Good. Take me on the road. I'll always be your hype, and I'll introduce you to any stage.
All right. I'm going to put you in the next Team Newman email. You'll be CC'd in that.
Oh, my gosh. I love it. Some of my favorite videos, and before I cordially connect with you, some of my favorite videos recently online have been the Team Newman, especially as you prepared for the heptathlon, learning the javelin. And that was entertaining as awesome. But thank you so much, Alysha, for being here. I know that there's a lot going on in your world. And just to take a moment to share with my audience, who happen to be a lot of women entrepreneurs, I'm so excited for the message you have to share. But just thank you for being here.
No, I'm super excited. And, you know, we had our brief conversation too. It's something so fun for me. People get to see this side of where am I mentally at in my career, how I got here, where I want to go with it. And it's really cool because who knows, one or two words or a sentence could just motivate somebody or inspire somebody to go after a goal or a dream they've been wanting to do. So anytime I get these opportunities, it's like, that's what I'm like here for. I'm here to leave an imprint in my world and to help people follow in my footsteps.
Oh, that's amazing. Well, I've already hyped you up. I want everyone to know I'm truly, truly a fan as I live vicariously through a lot of my favorite athletes. Alysha Newman is, you get what you see, and she is just absolutely incredible and takes the time to express and be genuine and authentic in every opportunity and situation. I value it. I appreciate it. But Alysha, I kind of want to tee you off by asking you a general question. I would love to hear from you. What is your sort of upbringing and background story like? Obviously, you've been involved in athletics for a very long time.
Yeah.
And we want to hear a little bit about the gymnastics story. But could you just tell us about sort of how you got to here?
Like, yeah.
Where you got from here? I'll pass it over to you.
Yeah, no, I think my story really started. I mean, I was raised with three siblings, so our house was constantly chaotic. We were going to dance competition, piano lessons, hockey games, swim championships. Like, it was nonstop in our family. And I think my whole parents were so good at making sure each one of our siblings spent time supporting each other in whatever they did. And I think that was a huge thing for us. My dad was very big in hockey and really wanted the boys, my brothers, to play hockey, which they did. But then I also bloomed as this athlete, and he's like, oh, like, she might be the athlete of the kids. And all my siblings are very athletic. They just chose a different route to go school and going to business and entrepreneurship, kind of like yourself, over, you know, risking going to the States and who knows what could happen after that, right? So my upbringing was never like selfish. It was like everybody got the attention they need. But I do believe my mom's mentality of loving is where my big heart comes from. And then my dad's will of like the underdog and constantly fighting for what you want and never giving up, that comes from my dad. So I remember before we could walk, my dad was throwing like objects in front of us crawling. Like, we had to figure out, like, as like a 9-month-year-old baby, like, do I go up on the pillow or do I go around the pillow? So I feel like from like day one, my dad's been like ingraining in my head that there's nothing that can be put in front of you that you can't get through. And so that's kind of where I really think my mentality was set into then becoming the best Canadian pole vaulter of all time that I can say right now, which is sometimes weird to say, and I have to pinch myself. But once they figured that side out and they saw that I was very, very advanced in any sport I did, it was one of those things. Like, I started as gymnastics and then every year I got better. And it almost was like a double-edged sword. So I liked school because of my friends, but I didn't like it because I actually didn't like sitting down and reading a textbook. That was just not my way of learning. I was very hands-on, right? And so, like, I was that 9-year-old in the barn with my dad changing the tires. So I know how to like stick shift. I know how to, you know, change tires. I know how to do my oil. Like, there's just everything very, you could say, alpha I was raised with, because it was, we didn't care if you were male or female in our family. We think you should equally know everything in life and learn as much as you can. And so once I started learning, I can control my outcome of, if you become a better athlete in gymnastics, you don't have to sit in school. You can do half days in school. So in my head, as a 9-year-old at this point, I was like, oh, if I go to level 8, level 9, I'll be training 36 hours a week. So I go half days in school and then I can be in the gym all day and I can play and I can compete and I can entertain. And that's where it really tapped in. And it just happened that I grew really tall at age 13 at that point. I grew like 5'6", and the skills got really, really hard for me with my long limbs, my long arms. There's a lot of body moving. And that's when I fractured my L5 vertebrae. So that was like my first big major injury as an athlete. And it was one of those things, like, we can push you through it, but we don't know what these outcomes. You could not grow any taller from this. You could be in a wheelchair later on if it doesn't heal properly. Those were just some, I guess you could say, from the doctors, and they're voicing their opinions, because what we were putting our bodies through at 13 years old was like crazy type of training. It's very, very drooling on the body and your mental state, because at that time, that's like when we're sponges as kids, right? We're learning everything, and all I knew was winning. Like, winning is good. So the things we would do and the extremes we would do to get that good there was not a lot of no's. It was, we have no choice, and we kind of just like push through it. So that's how my gymnastics, and I ended up taking a full year off of all athletics. I went back to school full time. I hated it. I was sad. I was depressed. My mom's like, we got to get her into something else. And that's when I found my love for track and field. And because I was beating all the boys at recess, we're playing soccer, baseball, I was getting to the bases faster than everyone. And the teachers called my parents and were like, you need to put her in track and field. So it started like that. And once they found out I was a gymnast and I could flip and do all these things, they're like, okay, let's put her at try her pole vault. Well, they said, takes 3 months to learn. I learned it and I broke the meet record the very first time. So it kind of chose me. And just seeing my name back up on a headline gave me this really cool adrenaline and sense. You know how like money for some people is like powering? For me as a child and like a teenager, I just loved my name at the top of a paper. Like, I thought that was so cool. Like, I'm on top, but not on top of like better than everyone, more like I'm on top. Like, nobody has jumped higher than me. So like, people are striving to be better than me. And so I raise the bar for them. And that's what I really got the pleasure in athletics, was walking around knowing like I'm one of the best. Like, I love that, you know, it's just a great feeling. And once I found that, it was game over. It was one year after another. Let's go. I was like, okay, I can go to university. Okay, cool. Okay, you can go to the Olympics. Oh, Alysha, you can actually go pro now. I was like, oh, damn, okay. Let me do that too. And then now I'm a full-time athlete and I get to do some really incredible things. And that's kind of my long story short, if that was short.
Brilliant. And I have a few interjections and comments, but I know we'll get into some of the other extracurricular things you get to do now as both social media influencer, entrepreneur, and even like model, and so many other things. We'll get into all that, but I wanted to mention something, Alysha. As a motivational speaker, I study a lot of the great motivators and some of the great classics, and I do a lot of reading. When I say reading, I listen to audiobooks.
But me too.
It's the only way to do it. I wish someone would audiobook all my textbooks from college.
Yes.
I wanted to share something with you. And I don't know if anyone's ever said this, so I'm honored to be one of the first, if not, but I'm sure you've heard this before.
Yeah.
Two great books that you remind me of. Mm. The first one is Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell.
Yes, I've seen
that. And in that book, Malcolm talks about the Canadian hockey players and the description of their life, the months they're born, and how that leads to the number of hours they put in before they go pro and before they make it to either the NHL or some of the top world opportunities to perform at that level. Yeah. And you don't fit the Outliers model based on your description of your story, given that you were injury prone, that you were sort of trying all the sports, gymnastics, and so much more, that makes you what he calls an anomaly.
Yeah.
And that means that your determination, your hard work, your ethics, your the way you present yourself and the way you were brought up are completely X factor in what you've done. And the reason why I say that is because I want my listeners and everyone to know that Alysha's worked damn hard for everything she's ever done, but she doesn't know any different. That's who she is. Mm-hmm. The second reference I wanted to share with you, and you're going to love this one, given that you have a recent interest in basketball a lot, is that there's another book called Relentless by Tim S. Grover, who is formerly the athletic trainer for Kobe Bryant and so many of the greats, and Michael Jordan. And he talks about the cleaners. And as one of the greatest pole vaulters of all time, you are a cleaner. And I don't know if anyone's told you that, but you're a cleaner. You clean house. You wrap up. You anyways, the podium.
Yeah, I love that.
The podium is always in threat when Alysha's when Alysha's on the track. And that's super cool. So I hope the hair on, you know, on our heads stick up.
No, it did. Idea,
but I'm proud to say that.
Yeah, it's so true. And I think that's like a huge thing for me was I really think there's that one goal left in my career that I'm striving for. And I think it didn't come yet because it wanted me to be in the sport longer. Because again, I want to do so much more than sport, and not that that's a negative. It's just, I love athletics and I love being that, but I've touched a lot of people in athletics and I'm ready to touch more people worldwide with my entrepreneurial skills and my wellness and my knowledge from being one of the best pole vaulters in the world and taking that mentality and sharing that with people in the future. I just think I get a lot more joy and happiness knowing I can help just with the simple words or, you know, presence or an aura and to motivate people. Like, I think that that's really what I was meant to be in. Pole vaulting was my base and my platform to lead me into this. So
very, very well said. I'm just excited for the mere chance that we got to chat about this, but I want to transition a little bit. We'll talk more about sports and some of your recent accomplishments, but I also wanted to share, given that we were just talking about college and the books and studying and friends and stuff like that, a lot of your experience is what creates, you know, your passion for music and food and so much more. And you, I don't know if foodie is the right term, but you are such a particular and knowledgeable person in the world of nutrition and food. Mm-hmm. How did that come about, given your background, your experience, your upbringing? Is it just something that you've been trained? Is it experience? Is it test and error, test trial and error? But how did you get to know so much about nutrition?
Yeah, I think that, so my whole life, I was, my family was a big, big motivator for that. It was, my mom and dad are just so smart and crazy. If you think about the way they did this, they, when we said we would go out and we wanted to do fast food, we wanted like burgers and stuff, they'd take us to restaurants with a full menu. Wow. So my whole life growing up, I thought fast food restaurants were restaurants, like everywhere. Fast, I didn't think like driving through, picking up a burger from McDonald's was fast food. I thought going to a Boston Pizza or a Pizza Hut, like that was my fast food. So everywhere I was around, it was like, oh, I'm so hungry, mom, I want it. But when I went to a restaurant, there's this whole list of all these foods. And I'm like, oh, well, I need to have a green and I need to have a grain and I need a protein. So like, that was like how it developed. But don't get me wrong, I took me, I would say 2016, that year that I made the Olympics, my first Olympics, I found it different. I was trying everything. I was buying meal plans from other athletes. I was seeing what worked good with me, what didn't, why I felt more bloated after stuff. Like, it was a trial and error for a very long time. And I also had, I would say grade 9 through to grade 12, I had body image problems. I felt like I didn't look like the other athletes. I was very feminist. I had kind of a bigger buttocks and my breast, and I was a little curvy, and I wasn't like jacked, but I had abs. And so I think my whole life in athletics, people were like, oh, she's so pretty. It wasn't like, she's so strong. And so that's where I developed a lot of my insecurities, because you always want what you can't have, right? Like, a lot of people that are strong and powerful and jacked want to be pretty, you know, or be defined as that, where I wanted to be defined as strong and powerful and inspirational. So I think that when I knew I was right there for the Olympics, and you know, I put in my 10,000 hours by that point, because I started at 15 and now I was like 21. And I knew that I had done my foundation and my base physically, and to get to that next level, it needed to be my eating habits. And I learned really fast that what I put in my body turned out onto the track. And it was, okay, if I'm going to have a huge practice tomorrow, or I'm jumping or I'm competing, I need to fuel my stuff with the best and the most hydrating thing that I can in my body, so that I don't make a mistake tomorrow. And if I make a mistake tomorrow, it's not because of my eating. So I like to limit the variables, if you could say, that I can control. And I learned that really quick. And to me, it was one thing at a time. It was, okay, let me take out gluten. I love gluten, but in season, I don't like to have it because it gives me cramps. It makes me feel lethargic in my workouts. And then I was like, oh, I wonder if I could get better. I took out dairy. Oh, I never got cramps anymore. I was able to like learn that. And then I started realizing eating every 3 hours for me, I had this energy of a lifetime. People are like, wait, you don't have to drink to have all this energy. You don't have to have coffee. You show up and you're like, you have so much energy. How do you do it? And I was like, because I'm constantly fueling my body. It needs it to like live and to be a person. So I think that that's why I learned. And if I didn't turn pro, if Nike never offered me in 2017, right after I graduated university, I actually applied for getting my master's in nutrition, just because I didn't know the details down to like BCAAs and whey protein. I didn't know all that. I just would listen to coaches or see what other athletes were doing. But I learned really fast that it doesn't matter if you're in an individual sport or a team sport, each thing you put in your body affects each person different. And so I could use everybody to like learn from them, but in the end, that never even helped me because it didn't work. So I needed to really test and trial and error to feel like, okay, like a lot of people don't know, I don't take protein. Like after a this is so funny. After a track practice or a crazy workout, I have just a raw chicken, not a raw, sorry, that sounds bad. Like a cooked, no spice, no nothing, just chicken breast that just got from my thing. And I just chew on that on the way home. Like so cool. So hot. and that's cause I just know like I'm going to get the best fuel from the most real food. Like of course, whey protein's awesome cause it's a quick, like replacement, but it's a replacement. Like, why wouldn't you go to the best of the best? And all you have to do is make time for it, you know? So that's why I kind of learn. And I love my wellness side because I'm very, very passionate for it because it's what makes me great. Like my base is already done. Like I've already put in my hours. It's like to get to that next level, you need to know what you're putting in your body and how it's affecting you.
Well, it's obvious that it's working. And so I think if there's a message that comes from that, it's have control over all the best products that you put in your body. That's amazing. Yeah. And it's so cool, Alysha, that it is working. It's something that's proven. It's like, look, if there's one thing amongst the many things and the hard training, it's what I put in my body that truly makes a massive difference. And so that's a lesson to the world.
Yeah. Oh, and it's huge. And I think, you know, every year you get better and you learn more about yourself. And then things change. You know, they say your taste buds change every 7 years, your hormones change every 7 years. So you got to reanalyze that. And the way I keep a data sheet for that is I get my blood taken every 4 months. I ask my doctor, she writes me a requisite. I go in, I get my blood taken. I know where my iron's at, where my B12 is at. Like I am on it because I'm trying to be the best and I want to be ahead in the most natural way possible because everything we do, we can always do that. Like literally it's all the resources are around us. We just have to literally take those steps to actually wanting it, you know, and doing it. Cause that's what's going to separate you into that 1% is doing stuff that people don't do daily to make themselves great.
Boom. That right here. Where's my, we have a little, we have something on the show. This is my mini microphone. And when it's dropped, it means the mic has dropped. That is it.
Oh man. My gosh, I need one of those. That's cute.
I'll get you one. They're awesome. I always carry it with me and interview people in public.
Awesome.
I have to share something with you as well. And this is for my audience, but as a lover of the sport, I'm a former decathlete, so I know a little bit about the pole vault, and I actually wrote about my pole vault experience in one of my latest books. But I wanted to share something with you as one of the greatest pole vaulters of all time. Mm-hmm. There's something that you've done for the sport that not many people talk about, but it's absolutely relevant. Yeah. When I watch the men go and do pole vault, you almost miss the fundamentals for success because of how fast they move, by the way they torque their bodies and how they're lunging themselves in the air. And it's hard to see really the tactics, but with the way Alysha jumps is so fine-tuned and almost to every ounce of movement and millimeter of movement, it is a perfect swing, a perfect projectile, and a perfect release. And I shouldn't use that word perfect because there's always room, right?
Sure.
But with the way you jump, the how tall you are, how big you are, and everything else, it is so much more fun to watch the fundamental of the sport evolve. Yeah. And there's something that you have in your gait, in your swing, which is a total, I guess that's the jargon of track, right? I got to talk to my listeners here, which the way she swings up the pole, it's harder to say, is different than all the other competitors. And it's really cool to watch that because you truly have evolved the sport in order to achieve 4 meters or higher, which is insane.
Yeah. Well, I think that, and that was the thing was, if we think about it, women's pole vault didn't get to the Olympics until 2000.
Right.
So when I started, it was a lot of videos were all males. And so I learned watching male athletes. And why wouldn't I watch male athletes? They are the best of the best all time, whether we like it or not. They jump the absolute highest. Take the gender out of it. They're jumping the highest. And so for me to jump the highest, I want to mimic the best in the world. So Sergey Bubka was my YouTube. You see, if you saw it when I was 15, it was like every night after practice, I would just watch him. Mm-hmm. And what I loved about him is he made it look flawlessly. He made it look easy. And he also made it look clean and pretty and safe. So that's what attracted me to the sport, was how artistic what we do is. Like, it's so much entertainment because not a lot of people do it. So it almost brings this sense of non-reality. And I think a lot of humans like to live in non-reality because half of the time a reality isn't the best all time, right? It's the world's hard to live in, and you know, it's negative and positive at some times. And so to see that side of me as a pole vaulter, I love watching me vault because I think it's so pretty and it's artistic. And so I appreciate you saying that, because that is one of my biggest accomplishments. No Olympic medal is like a huge sad thing for me, but I will definitely be able to say I'm technically textbook perfection for my pole vault team, because that's what I learned. I was like, per fingernail placement, I was like, where am I going to put it to make it look and be the most efficient and safest way to get me over that high bar? And that's kind of like what I'm very thankful for in the last 10 years of my career.
Yeah. Yeah. And Mal, beautifully said. I wanted to transition and ask you, what are some of your goals as you're progressing the sport as not only just a female, but as a strong athlete?
Yeah.
There's the Olympic dream, but that's one stage out of the many stages. The Commonwealth Games were huge. The World Championships were huge. Tell me a little bit about some of your next goals.
Yeah. Well, I mean, of course, like my number one up there on the list is always going to be my Olympic medal. I think it's not even about being the first Canadian pole vaulter woman to bring home an Olympic medal. It's just, I want a hardware for my hard work is what I talk to my neurologist about. It's like, I don't even care what comes with it. I just want, you know, like you get your degree at the end of your 4 years of like stress and sleepless nights. It's like my blood, sweat, tears, broken back, broken knee. I was like, I just want a piece of hardware that I can sit there and be like, I gave everything to that. So that's obviously my number one goal. But right now we're in the works. There's so much going on. I mean, my foundation, it's heading in the most beautiful way and where we want. What I can say is I definitely want to build a track in London, Ontario. I want it to be the Newman Hero Center facility. We haven't really named it yet. And I want it to be a wellness for the next generation. So I think that that's going to be really, really cool. And a different side that people don't know that I'm doing kind of behind the scenes, raising money and getting that going. So that's a big, big goal of mine, is to get a facility up there for not just Olympians and the next generation. I want the community to use track, because when you have track base, you become fitter head to toe. And so I wish there was facilities indoors and outdoors for the general public to be able to use, because running and that makes you even more healthy. And then that's when we go into my wellness side. And I have dreams and fantasies, and I talk about it all the time, on opening a wellness clinic that has hyperbaric chambers, cold tubs, hot tubs, IV bags. I want to have kind of like a one-stop shop it's kind of like a fast food thing. After work, or the company hires us on lunchtime, we come in, we refuel you. We're kind of like, you know, filling up gas, we refuel you, and you're ready to do the next part of your day, or you're recovering from your crazy stressful day at work, or you're training or helping athletes recover. So that's kind of where I want that facility to go. And I would start it in Toronto and then slowly move it out to Vancouver and see if I can go worldwide with it. But that's like where my entrepreneurial side, and We already have the name, the One Body, One Life. I own it. I bought it. I own the domain name. And so we just are, that's like where I'm going to, you're going to just see like after Paris. It depends. I probably will do one more year after Paris just to kind of do a victory lap.
Yeah.
But I'll definitely be tapping into it, and I'll be turning 30 that year. So tapping into my 30s, going from professional athlete to one of the best entrepreneurs, or putting in those 10,000 hours to become one of the best entrepreneurs. So that's kind of my goals.
Man, a lot. Man, the hair on my arms is sticking up. I'm so excited and pumped up for you. I wanted to add something too. It's brilliant, and go Team Newman for preparing and assisting you in that, I guess, the encore career. There's so much more to life than just the track and field sport, but there is so much about life in that sport. And something that we talk about a lot on this show with many of the people I've had on here is speaking your desires into existence, and just keep on saying your dreams, because Toronto, we're gonna do whatever we can to get this dream of Alysha's to build that facility. I cannot wait, and congratulations in advance, because it's definitely worthwhile persisting. I'm very, very impressed and really excited for you too. And I think for the first time in my life, I'm ready to live vicariously, not through the screen, but I'll probably be going to Paris myself. To wave the flags of Team Newman and have some fun there. But I wanted to ask you a little bit, if you wouldn't mind sharing, let my listeners know about your foundation, what it's about, what you guys do. It's a really, really impressive organization, but tell us how we can learn more and support the foundation.
Yeah. So again, I just launched it on my birthday. That was like it was very last minute. It was like, and if you know me, okay, I go out, but I don't drink a lot. So when I do my parties, like every year, I get to see all my high school friends, all my family, friends, because I'm traveling all year, is my birthday. So everyone knows Alysha Newman throws a massive birthday party every year. It's just what I do. So I said, this year, I don't want gifts. I don't need that. That's not what I want to like bring people back out. I said, I really want to get this foundation up and running. And so we did it within 4 weeks. We partnered with London Community Foundation. And so we're a branch off, because it takes a while to get government approval and stuff. But eventually we'll just be partnered with them for that. And I cannot believe the turnout, just from friends and family, and doing a soft launch. And the whole motto behind it was, when I was at my lowest and I felt like I couldn't go more, when I had my concussion, when COVID hit, I was literally third in the world in 2019, like with all this positive, I was ready for Tokyo 2020. And I'm not saying COVID was the reason I didn't do well, but the timing messed me up, because I got my concussion in 2021, right before the Olympics, and I kind of fell off. And I think in my head, it was like, do I quit? Why am I doing this? I'm sad. And I kept reminding myself, like that inner superhero kept saying, please, Alysha, do not make a decision at your lowest moments in your career. And it was like, I kept seeing that, even though I was like, okay, maybe I can just go right into my wellness. I have a big brand. Why don't I just go into it? And just a part of me could not let go. And it was that inner superhero. So I really appreciated that superhero fighting for me in the inside. And that's where the motto came from. It was, the Newman Hero Foundation should be a place of feeling like your absolute best, going in to be your absolute best and giving your absolute best. And that's what I want that facility to be represented by. I literally feel like you're only as great as the environment and the people you're around. And if I could build a community and a foundation that allows people to feel empowered and leveled up higher than what they were yesterday, that's what I want people in that environment. So I guess you could say it came from like not giving up. And I want people to know it's like in you. And if I can, I guess you could say, if I could like light that superhero for people, and when they see hero, I think it's a magic automatic trigger in your pathways, right? So it subconsciously just triggers you as like, oh, strong power. When you hear a hero, you think strong and powerful. So yeah, it's like this goes deep into my like neural. Yeah. We'll have to have a whole other podcast for that.
Let's
one.
Do it. Yeah, we'll schedule that next.
That goes really deep into like subconsciously and even how you're thinking and self-taught. I think just having the word hero on a huge billboard or the Newman hero, I want it to trigger something in people's minds to go do it. Whatever you're thinking or you want to do or you want to accomplish, turn it on. Let's go. So that's where the Newman Hero. But yeah, you can literally find it. The website is the Newman Hero Foundation. You can donate there. Right now, we're doing a couple more fundraisers. We're going to do a golf tournament and then kind of see where we'll go from there. We're actually doing a couple like personal donors right now. We're just getting that figured out. So yeah, if anybody wants to donate, you can send an email. It's all on the website.
Absolutely. Yeah, I definitely want to send people there and many of my connections. What I hear you saying in all this, and I want to thank you for that, and I want my listeners to understand, Alysha, one of the greatest pole vaulters of all time, if not already the greatest pole vaulter of all time, just told you, to my listeners, that you all have superpowers.
Yep.
And that you all can be a hero. Mm-hmm. And it starts within, right? You need to be you need to use your superpowers and be a hero to yourself and then help others along the way. And that's what we are all about. And I walk away from this conversation far more inspired, tenfold excited to serve more people and to create that and to support others in the foundations that they're creating. And so I want to thank you for that. That was really cool.
No, I appreciate it. I think it's so awesome. That's been such a positive thing for podcast and these type of, you know, communications that we have. It's like, I'm leaving here now feeling even more empowered because you and I chatted. So even if no one listens to it, you and I are going to go and feel really great after this conversation. And we need more of that. We need to have conversations that are positive and uplifting, not gossip and drama and all this other stuff, because, you know, it's hard to live in the world we live in. And so to listen and to feel reassured that everyone's really going to be okay. And you just need to find that inner superpower.
There it is. There it is. And by the way, for all my listeners, we'll put all the links to her foundation, her website, the One Body website as well, and just how to follow and connect. If you guys don't follow Alysha Newman on social media, you definitely should. She's extremely entertaining. She's super fun, but she's doing so much good for the world. I have a couple random questions for you before we get to the meat and potatoes, and I just wanted to ask you, have any movie producers approached you about being next one of the roles of I'm thinking either Wonder Woman or any one of the Amazon ladies or anything like that? Have you been approached to be on any sets?
I'm laughing so hard because I just hired an acting coach. So I work with her once a week right now, and it's whenever I'm on my downtime. That's my goal, is to be in a Marvel movie after Paris. So yes, I'm learning everything I didn't get to learn going to school for it. So having her coming and us taking time and finding different roles and finding what I like, honestly, but we definitely think it's going to be like the superhero track. That's where I'll go into after Paris.
That's cool. You heard it here, folks. Just me.
No, I haven't told nobody. So yeah, you heard it here first.
That's absolutely incredible. Well, again, full support and excitement for their a slew of nominations and positive awards coming your way. I know from my listeners who are involved in a lot of things online and a lot of really great connections and galas and things that are going to come about. So much success to you. When does your next season begin? You're probably in a period of vacation right now. When does the season start for you?
Yeah. So our start date's October 1st, which is like a Saturday. So I'll probably have to go for like a 30-minute run because I haven't really run in the last 6 weeks. And I'll still get cramps and it'll suck for the first 2 weeks back. But after 2 weeks, and that's what I love telling people, stick in it for 14 days, whatever's really hard. And I promise you day 15, you're like, oh, I can do this. This is easy. But yeah, so pretty much I start October 1st, and then heading all the way. January is when we'll start competing, but we usually do 12 weeks of base training. So that's like me not drinking crazy ever. I do like my glass of wine though. It really relaxes me. And then literally sleeping all day. And I actually just bought my hyperbaric chamber. So my hyperbaric chamber is in my house. So we're going to do a little Instagram reel for that. So that'll be kind of cool to show people how I'm like upping my level. Because, you know, you get to a point too as an athlete, it's like, how do you become better? And to me, it's not physical anymore. It was my mind is blocking me from being great. And I'm like, I need to not feed my bad monster anymore. So we're working and doing all these other things right now. It's going to be weird. It's not going to be, oh, you have to like grind 6 a.m. two workouts a day. It's no, Alysha, you're going to go literally motivate, or you're going to go do your breathing. You're going to go lay in your hyperbaric chamber. You're going to do your ice tub in the morning to get things fired. And you're going to think positive. I have literally goals all over my walls in my house. Everywhere I walk, I see my goals. And it's just going to be a different type this year, because that's how you have to do it. You have to change it up because your body gets adapted to. I feel like I can talk about this stuff forever. I'm sorry. I'm just rambling on.
Not at all. Again, the reason why I do this podcast in the first place is I get to be front row student, taking notes. And I love learning this, but I get to learn vicariously through the hearts of the people that listen to this podcast. But Alysha, a few more questions for you, and I want to respect your time. So if you have a few more minutes, just let me know when you have to hop off, because we could talk track stories all day long.
I know. But hyped.
Man, I know that we'll share a glass of wine one day and hang out. But I know that you inspire so many people through this message. And one thing I continue to ask the Olympians that I've interviewed and talked to is that no one will ever really understand how hard you have to work to be the best. You just went through a slew of opportunities that entail your day. And I want to ask you a couple just questions about that. You obviously have a team, you have coaches, but who is telling you to do all of those things, to eat right, to get into the hyperbolic or whatever, the chamber? That sounds funny, but just who is kind of pushing you along? And I think this answer will surprise many, as I think it's not as obvious as it would assume. But what would you answer to that? Who's pushing you along?
I think it's going to be funny. My failures. I think I literally I'm not settled. Like, my failures motivate me and my success reassure that I'm on the right path. That's literally what I live by. And I literally think I've been through hell and back the last 3 years in my career and my track career. And it's just like, it's building. Like, there's this demon inside that's like ready to be like released. And I'm just, it's hard to be in it when you're in it, but when you start seeing the positive reinforcements, you're like, it's worth it. And so I don't think there's a person, you know, I need my team. But it's definitely my failures and my mistakes that like make me feel like I can be better. So yeah, that.
Powerful. I'm so glad you said that. And I had an intuition, but I'm really, really grateful you shared that, because many people, especially my listeners, they're in this entrepreneurial space of needing to know what to do to perfectly put themselves in a place where they can find success. And if you don't have that inner drive, if the failures don't fuel you to overcome your greatest challenges, then you're going to find a recycling system of continuous shortcomings to your goals. And we teach that, we talk about that on this, and it's both physical and mental and in many ways applicable.
When I think people think you get to a point where it's like, oh, I have to make this, or I have to do this. And it's like, my world would be great when that all happens. And, you know, I talk to a lot of gold medalists all the time, and they're not happy because they won a gold medal. They're happy because they've been through this journey of like hard work and dedication, and it paid off. And that's why I got this tattoo of like the infinity. I don't know if you can see it with my AN. And it was because I would feel like I would write a goal and I would accomplish it, and I would feel like, okay, I'm done. But it's like your journey never stops. Like, it's a continuous thing, and it's literally, I know it sounds so cliche, like your journey, you should like embrace your journey. But like, honestly, like even though you get, you think you get to the best of your best and you're making the best money, you think you, there's always more, or there's like another accomplishment you can do. And so I used to get a lot of anxiety because I'd be like, hey, what do I do now? I have everything, or I got this, or I'm doing this. And I think that that is really hard for people to realize, like, doesn't get easier. You just keep living, and you live for the positives, and you figure out and you problem solve when it's bad. And that's what makes like a life purposeful, you know? So I really do enjoy my failures. Like, I sit in them deep, and I love it. Because it's just like, oh, you think you won. Nuh-uh, you have no idea. And it's just a different type of a beast for sure. And I think people need to like embrace that more.
Yeah.
Pause, you know.
Everything you just said reminds me of an article that was written on Michael Phelps. And there's a photo of one of his greatest competitors, but yet was always second place to him. An American, of course, to him. And he was eventually beat out by the awesome Canadians. But what happened was there was a photo snapped by a photographer where Michael is inches from touching the wall to finish the race, while his greatest nemesis or competitor, I'm not going to name names here, but he's looking at Michael without looking at the wall. He's about several inches further behind. And the photographer interviewed Michael afterwards and asked him, like, what do you think of this? And he's like, look, winners focus on winning. Losers focus on the winners. And you just described that to a T, that your failures become the thing that you marvel in most, because they're the keys to your success in everything you do. And that's just powerful, Alysha.
And that's the thing. It's like your perspective. You gotta realign what is the importance. You know, we're not competing. People in life aren't competing. We're all trying to be great, and there's literally enough room for everybody at the top. You just have to have the mindset that you're going to be like at the top, and be valued, that you deserve to be at the top. Like, I think that's another big thing. So
it's brilliant.
Oh, this was a great, this was great. That got me motivated.
Okay, a couple more quick questions for you. I want to be respectful of your time. Number one, we saw online that you recently competed in a heptathlon, which makes you an octathlete. Tell us a little bit about your experience as competing in the heptathlon. Did you like it? Was it cool? Was it an extracurricular project? Just give us a little background.
The whole background was I started it because I wasn't allowed to pole vault for 6 months after my concussion. And it was one of those situations, I do so much. It was like, if I step away from the track longer than 2 months, I probably was going to retire. And I, like I said, there was that, still that inner person being like, you're not done yet. So long story short is I started just training with Pierce Lepage, our silver medalist, our Canadian silver medalist. And then also training down in London with Damian Warner, our gold medalist. And it was something that like I've never really... It challenged me in a different way, because pole vaults, you have to be composed and you have to simplify it. You got to like layman's term it, because there's so much going on. You can't be sporadic. You can't be a powerful athlete. You have to be control when you're hitting your steps. So what I really loved about HEP and decathlon was like, you can just release the beast, you know? And I loved it. I love with the gun start and hurdling and getting over the hurdles and knowing it's technical, but you can really just show your true athleticism in 7 events and showing your head to toe, like why you're a great athlete. And it did challenge me though. It was, you know, getting to that like 800 meter and me being like, why am I even doing this? It was crazy, because I'm sitting here, I'm like, what? Now I have to run 2 laps as fast as I can. Like, I cannot feel my legs. So I think that was fun for me. It showed me a little bit more why I chose track and field, when potentially I could have been in tennis maybe, or golf. And I just picked up golf too the last year, so that's been fun. And that's what I love about track, is it's accessible for everybody and it challenges you. Every day you're there, you can always be better. And so that's what I vibed and kept me in sport, was heptathlon training last year. So I won't lie to you. I think my last ever Well, I'll be between a pole vault meet, but I probably will try the women's deck and break the Canadian record for women's deck so I can have both and see what I can do like on a world stage for women's deck, because I don't have the, could you say I don't have the hours and days sure. to do women's hep and try to do it internationally. But I think a women's deck with my pole vault, I think I really could put a show on. Like I put in my personal best because, you know, like the chart, right? For yeah. like how they score point it. Values. So I put in my pole vault and I think I would score like 1400 points with just my pole vault. So I was like, okay, well, I should probably focus on the other events. So yeah, that's like my goal. And the why, what turned out to be was like, you know what? You don't want to do it professionally. That's fine because you're still an elite pole vaulter. But it helped my pole vault. Like I literally within, that's what was the craziest thing. I took up hep all season last year and I hit world standard and became top 10 in the world again with less than 2 months of training for pole vault because of my hep training. So that's what I like to tell people is like sometimes staying in that one lane, that one box doesn't challenge you. And like as yeah. soon as you try to do something, and I just happened to pick it up because I wanted to stay around the track. Well, it helped me with my pole vault. So that's why I always tell people, keep open-minded on stuff like that, because you never know when, that's what I also love. I see it everywhere. You're one choice away from changing your entire life. And like, that's what I tell people, make those choices, especially if it's like gut instinct for sure.
I love that. I'm going to quickly transition. There's so much you and I can talk about.
I know.
We're definitely going to have to schedule part two, but I had to ask too, just to cover all of our bases. Yeah. Being the change the tire, fix the car, daughter to your father. I know that modeling has been part of your life. That's something that you've recently, or I guess in the last while, have been embracing. Mm-hmm. And did you ever think that that would be part of your life, given how you grew up and who you think you are, mm-hmm. and given what you said earlier that I want to be strong, I didn't want to be, you know, what you said. Tell me a little bit about your journey as a model and what that's mm-hmm. done for you as well.
Yeah, so I actually, when I retired gymnastics, I took a year off of athletics to heal my back. So I actually went in to, like, I did a portfolio. I went into an agency and with the time that I took off and by the time we got everything and she got the files, we came in for a meeting and she goes, hey, Alysha's going to have to choose between modeling and track because her muscles are a little too big for being a high fashion model. And at that time, it was a big, like, that was a thing. The models were very, very small. They didn't have muscle. And I was like, oh, she just called me strong. That was what tapped into my head. I wasn't even upset about it. I was like, okay, mom, I don't want to model. I'm going back to the track. I'm just doing track. And that was my decision because it was exactly what I wanted people to know me as. I wanted people to see me and see strong and see muscle. But I was always so feminine and looking, and I didn't like it because I wanted to be the best athlete, you know? Yeah. So when she said that, I knew I was going to be in the right decision and to take my track career. Now I'm very, very fortunate. We're in a world that a lot is acceptable in the modeling career. And I've learned through the years, I really just love creating a character, like bringing things to life. And my creative side is like, okay, I want this like mystery, and like I tap into it. I'm like, all right, let's do it. But what I have found about modeling versus commercial is modeling is very edited. So it's editorial. So, you know, if you get a bad angle or you have a zit on your face, you know, they remove it. And I started hating that side of modeling. Mm-hmm. And that's why I've transferred over to commercials, because I think people see my smile, people see myself, and I like portraying positive energy through a camera. So that's what I've done with my modeling career. A lot of times I try to do campaigns that are videos because I don't want to edit my stuff. I don't want people to think, you know, this picture is truly me when half of the time it's edited, you know? Right. So that was kind of my modeling career. And I mean, again, long story short, it's not always short with me, but I tried modeling and I do it, but it's not my, oh, I love it. You know, it's not that. It's one of those things that I love doing because I love creating cool imagery. art. Again, it goes back to this art. Maybe I should be like an art master or something.
the Picasso of athletics, yes. Really. Well, you're definitely perpetuating a better world and a greater world of acceptance, which is incredible. And I wanted to add that. Last question for you, and this is just the meat and potatoes of what we do here. As one of the greatest, and if not already the greatest of all time, what's your golden nugget of advice to anyone listening today or in the future to take immediate action on and to do something with where they're at today? If you had a nugget of knowledge you learned in the process or any part of your life and experience, what would you share with the world?
That's a good one. I try to change this up because it changes for me daily. True. But I would say, I always loved when my Pippa would say, it could always be worse. I really think I like to take that and internalize it for before I make really crazy decisions. So I try to always think, A, it could be worse. And then B, I go into, okay, what do we do? Problem solve. How do I fix this? How do I not feel like this? And then that's when I really tell people, like, try to tap into your gut instinct, which is usually the first 15 seconds of your thought process. And then after, it becomes overthinking based off of heart and mind, which is not usually the best choice because the mind overthinks and the heart does based off of emotions, where the gut is very more straightforward. So I always say that it could always be worse and go with your gut instinct, which is 15 set. Seconds. Put the timer on. You got 15 seconds to make a decision.
That's amazing. And yeah. Thank you for sharing that. I concur all of it. I love being the student in this opportunity. And Alysha, thank you just for inspiring my listeners, inspiring all of us, and continue to be who you are and never change that. I know I don't need to tell you that because your pep talk to yourself is the failures are fueling your successes. Mm-hmm. And I recognize that. I've already just like learned a lot. I'm such a note taker. I've been writing little sticky notes for myself that are the reminders to myself and what I'm working on and what we're doing. But I want to support you. I want to print t-shirts and say Team Newman all the way. But I want to send my listeners to you, follow you, to support you. Go check out her products online. Go check out what she's doing. She's more than an athlete. She's developing into a world leader, an entrepreneur, I would say the feminine leader of strong versus beautiful as well. And I'm just so impressed. And I stumble over my words because I literally am sitting in a Zoom room / virtual setting with really one of my heroes. But I just want to thank you for all the things you said. And one of the things you said behind stage that I wanted to get to this later, but given that your mom is your bestie, I just wanted to thank you for saying that back behind stage, because that really does mean a lot. And just showing you how family and support have been a huge part of what you do and how you've grown up. I wanted my listeners to see that too, because one of the things we talk about on this show is creating your support system and delving into that and leaning into those who give you the greatest inspiration. So I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. Obviously we need a part two, and
yes,
so
we do. Much more opportunity.
From the Circle of Knowledge podcast and from everyone else on the team, we wish you the greatest skill. We don't say good luck. We say good skill to October 1st and then your upcoming season. We're behind you and we're excited for you.
Well, thank you so much. This was so nice. And I have now free energy for the rest of the day.
That's what we create. Well, you guys have had the opportunity to hear from the greatest in the world. She's changed and evolved the sport of pole vaulting, and yet she's just getting started. Mm-hmm. There's so much more. I'm thrilled, honored, and just privileged to have had this conversation to highlight her. And Alysha, thank you for joining us on the Circle of Knowledge podcast.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. And with that being said, everybody, we'll tune in next time. Join us on the next hour and the next show. And just remember, everything you need is within you now. Just take the necessary steps and put yourself into immediate action, and you'll find yourself in a place you weren't before. With that being said, we're signing out with Alysha Newman on cast. We're going to be joining next time with another great speaker, and we'll see you guys next time.
Mm-hmm.